This is Vishwak working with QFox. You can see the logo of QFox with the website URL here. So I hope everyone is seeing my screen. You can respond in chat. Yes, thank you. So let's get started with the session now. So our course is about API, completely about API web services. It's functional testing, automation testing, and the different tools that we use to do functional testing and as well as automation testing. So we have been listening to few words related to API and web services like this. So here is few terms we have been listening to: API, web service, API testing, web services testing, REST or RESTful API, web services testing, SOAP or SOAP web services, HTTP and HTTPS, functional API testing, web services automation testing, tools used for automation. So these are the few contents related to the API, so which we have been listening to. I am considering these are the high level contents of our course, so we can dig deeper into all these contents and we can learn everything related to all these sources. So in order to see the whole course contents, we can go through our website QFox here. So you can see the whole course contents here, and here is the course name, API automation, with all the concepts covered including the projects, and as well as you can see the PDF and you can download as well. So here is the summary and as well as prerequisites followed by the course contents. So it is starting with basics.
Vishwak, can you show that, because we are not seeing that on our screen. Like, did you click that?
Yeah, sure.
Yes, we are expecting to see the contents.
Yeah, sure. I think now everyone is able to see the page.
Yes,
in our site. So here is the QFox. In our site, we are providing all the contents related to our course. So here is the PDF. PDF contains the summary and as well as the prerequisites, and followed by the contents and its sub contents as well. So here you can see the basics, which covers introduction to API, and followed by the client server architecture, and then introduction to the API, followed by the URL and its parts, and followed by the API parts, and then what are web services, and then its subcontents, and then HTTP protocol, how we will be using the HTTP protocol in web services, and followed by the basic Java concepts which we require for writing the automation code to test the APIs. And it has few key concepts like introduction as usually, and followed by the basic OOPS concepts, followed by strings, exception handling, collections, JDBC, followed by the threads. So which are the key concepts that we require to write the automation code for APIs, followed by SOAP and REST API concepts, difference between them, and what are the architectures of them we will discuss, and followed by the functional testing tools, that is the Postman tool, which is the functional API testing tool required for managing and performing the testing functionally, and as well as partial automation is also possible using the Postman, followed by Swagger. This is a developer kind of tool which developers mostly use to expose the APIs. We will see the all differences between Postman and Swagger, and as well as we can explore Swagger UI itself to do functional testing of API, and followed by a few browser tools. We anyway will be explaining about few extensions to test the APIs. So we will be covering those things as well, and followed by a few automation tools, that is primarily the HTTP client, which includes few subcontents, how it can be used to test APIs and automate the APIs, and we can write the framework as well, followed by other framework or the tool API testing automation tool, which is the REST Assured. We can see about that as well. So here are the list of the subcontents under REST Assured, and then real-time automation examples, how actually companies approaching to test the APIs in a different manner. So here is the few types of tests, and followed by these are the tools, and JMeter and Fiddler. Fiddler is also one kind of a tool like Postman and Swagger, and JMeter is the tool which provides services like performance testing, and API also requires performance testing, how we can configure those tests, and how we can work with JMeter we will see under this, and as well as about the Fiddler as well, and followed by the SOAP UI tool, which covers all the features of SOAP. SOAP UI tool. SOAP UI actually provides all kinds of testing activities, which includes functional, automation, performance, resiliency kind of. So we will discuss all the things under this, and followed by a few things to cover, assignments, questions, followed by exercises like that. So this covers our course, which is the list of whole contents and its subcontents. So let's get back to our presentation.
Vishwaka.
Yeah.
Sridhar is asking us our chat whether Apache HTTP client is similar to REST Assured library or.
Yeah, so it is same like REST Assured.
Oh, okay, sure. Thank you.
So it is a another kind of library provided by Apache providers. So this is another kind of tool which we can work with. And we're also seeing some other question related to SOAP UI or SOAP UI Pro. So we will actually start with SOAP UI, and then we will try to cover few things about SOAP UI Pro as well, including scripting and all.
Okay, Vishwa, go ahead.
Yeah. So, so far we covered about the contents and the subcontents of our course. And then before going to actual course contents or into the pure technical things, we try to understand why are we into this course and why actually we are concentrating on API and its testing. And we will getting into it a bit slowly. So we actually so let's get started with a few human needs. So these are the primary needs that every human has. So we actually have to pay utility bills, booking tickets, booking car travel, car to travel to somewhere, and as well as so these are the few needs. How these needs are connected to our API and as well as API testing. So suppose let's take first need, that is paying utility bills. So we actually paying our utility bills monthly basis. So let's consider one example, that is paying electricity bill. So this is the most common bill that we usually pay monthly. So if you want to pay this electricity bill, we can directly pay through the government official website, or we can go through the electricity department office and we can pay that. So let's put aside the offline method for now and then concentrate on the paying online through its website. So let's consider we are going to the official website to pay the electricity bill. It includes two steps. First, to verify whether bill is generated or not. So as soon as you go through electricity website, you will be entering your electricity service number, and then you will be getting the amount to be paid for that month. So this is the first action. And then as soon as you see the bill, you will be paying the amount. So these are the two actions that the website is providing. So the whole process, getting the information from the system and then paying the amount, is happening in the same website or in the same application, is called as monolithic application. So a system which is providing all kind of services itself in a single container or in the single system is called as monolithic system. So apart from this, we are nowadays we are not paying not only paying that electricity bill using actual website, but we can also pay using other third party vendors like Paytm, FreeCharge, or PayU Money, some other else. So here what happening is, our official website is providing services to those third party vendors to pay the bills towards the electricity department. So here what is happening is, if suppose we can take the Paytm, so you go to the Paytm, you will enter the service number, that is electricity bill number. As soon as you enter the electricity service number, you will be the amount to be paid. So here the Paytm that you are accessing is not the actual electricity website, but you will get the information related to your service number from actual government official site. So here what is happening is, you will get the amount and you will be paying the amount through the payment gateways of Paytm itself, but the service is happened and the service is worked even with other vendors as well. So if you are using Paytm heavily, it will be easy for you to pay your utility bills using the Paytm itself, and you can avoid going to official website or going to the laptop, and you can open official website and then paying the amount. So the ease of services providing by the actual system to the other services is provided by microservice architecture. So this kind of architecture we call as microservice architecture. So the actual website is providing subservice of its service to the other services we called as microservice architecture. So we have been seeing two things here. First is the monolithic architecture and then is the microservice architecture. So we can see the slide to understand clearly about what actually the microservice and the monolithic. So here is the monolithic. I hope everyone is seeing my slides here. So here is the monolithic. Monolithic is a single system which provides all the services related to its system. But here is the microservice. The whole system is divided into subservices and serves the same purpose. We can go a bit more technical. Like here you can see we actually using many online shopping systems. So here you can see UI followed by cart, payment and management, gateways followed by the DB. Here UI is nothing but the user interface. If you can take the Flipkart or Amazon, you will be, as soon as you navigate through their website, you will be seeing the UI presenting with the different items. So that is we can call as user interface. As soon as you select the item, you will be navigated to the cart part. And if you want to do, if you want to delete or edit the cart items, you will be going into the management page. And if you want to pay the amount, you will be navigated to payment page followed by the gateways, and the status of all these things updated into the DB. So this is the one single system. All the services are happening in the single system itself. So all the contents, all the services which are tightly coupled to one single application. But in case of microservice, what is happening is UI is developed as separate component and followed by the cart system with DB and payment system with database and management system with database and gateways with the database. So every component, or we can simply call it as a subservice of the application, is developed, tested and deployed separately and or connected with the interfaces. So these interfaces we called as programming interfaces. So this kind of architecture we called as microservice architecture. So why are we moving from this monolithic architecture to the microservice architecture? we can understand a bit later. So here is the definition of both monolithic architecture. It's an all-in-one piece, self-contained, components of it are interconnected and interdependent and are tightly coupled. So this is the definition of monolithic, and followed by the microservice architecture. So it is obviously a bit different with the monolithic. So it is a small encapsulated component which will be developed and tested and deployed individually and connected through the programming interfaces. And obviously it is the loosely coupled things. So we are trying to understanding two architectures here, and we are going for monolithic to microservice, and we will try to understand now why more microservice is coming into the picture. So here few differences between the two architectures. So before understanding the actual technical differences and why are we going from this service to other service, we will try to understand why actually we require this movement from monolithic to microservice. So here nowadays one common human is connected with all kind of services over the internet using his smartphone. Towards connecting, he is able to access the videos and can do the shopping and can access the he can book the car to travel to somewhere, and followed by the he can access the maps where he actually moving to, and then followed by some business application, and then capturing and then booking flight tickets. Like that, human is connected to the world itself with a smartphone. So this is the very basic requirement why we are going to microservice architecture from the monolithic. So not only this, we require our system to support many various devices like this. So we are not only using a simple PC to do all of our services in internet. We are actually using different mobiles, tabs, and then the systems. So we are able to access our system everywhere, and we can do all these things at our fingertips. So this is also the other requirement. And followed by, so we are not only using three to four devices, but so these many devices we will be using. That's why we need our system compatible with all the devices. If a system which is developed depends on the monolithic architecture, which can be useful only to the computer but not applicable for the mobile system. But if we develop our system depends on the microservice architecture, so irrespective of the user interface that we are providing, irrespective of the device that we are using, irrespective of the language that we are developing, it provides the services to each and every device and as well as each and every user interface, and can serve the same purpose. So which these are the three basic things. That's why we are moving from monolithic to microservice architecture. So we can try to understand the technical things why many tech stars like Netflix, Amazon, and eBay, Twitter, Facebook, why these people converted or moved from monolithic development to the microservice architecture. So here these are the actual performance things to be considered to differentiate these two architectures. So I think in the first session these will be the too much technical, but we will try to understand in a simple words. First is the agility. So this is the one characteristic of architectures. It is simply nothing but ability to move quickly. So let's try to understand this thing. Suppose we have an application that requires some extra features to be added, tested and deployed as quickly as possible. That is, this is nothing but a simple change that needs to be moved to the live system. So in case of monolithic, this takes lots of time as it requires the whole system compilation with all the components and the whole system testing. It can be automation or the regression kind of thing, and the whole system deployment should happen to the live. So it takes a lot of time in case of agility. While into the microservice architecture, if we want to add a new feature, we can take that new feature as a subservice. We can develop the subservice independent to the whole system, and we can deploy that service independent to the whole system, and we can interface with that service, and we can add those services to the existing application. So it takes very less time. And the second characteristic is development. Development happens on a single programming language because it is a whole system. It is a single system which includes all the services provided by that particular system, and all the subservices are contained in a single container. That's why we have to use a single programming language. Here is one drawback is, as we are only using a single language, means it may or may not provide all the services which we require for our system. But in case of microservice architecture, each individual component can be developed and tested and deployed individually and can access the services of it using our whole application. And the next is the maintenance. As well with the monolithic architecture, it contains all the subservices included, hence resulting in the long source code, resulting in the heavy maintenance. While coming to the microservice architecture, it is a if we found any issue, so we will be considering a subservice. In that, we can fix that subservice issue and then we can deploy the particular service, which no way affects the whole system, hence which is simple to maintain. And next is the very important characteristic, that is scalability, capacity to be changed on scale, kind of memory or kind of handling the things, so which will be increased horizontally with the features that we are going to add with the system in monolithic manner. But in case of microservice, we can add that particular feature as a subcomponent, and there is no need of horizontal scalability here. So which reduces so much efforts and as well as the usage of systems, as well as availability. Availability of code is necessary in the application development. As soon as you get an issue or a bug in the system, you will be able to fix the issue as soon as possible. But in case of monolithic, it is a long code. It includes all the contents or the all subservices. You could take extra time than microservices to fix the issue. So these are the few technical things to differentiate the monolithic and microservice architecture. And I hope everyone understood.
Vishwak, one thing, we have one question actually. So the question is like, how much Java is required for this course? Is the question. So are we covering all the Java that is required for API automation also?
Yeah, yes. So we actually covering all the Java concepts which we require to do automation for API testing using automation tools, that is Apache and as well as Apache HTTP client as well as the REST Assured.
Okay, you mean to say that whatever the API automation requires, that extent of Java will be covered, right?
Yeah, yes.
Okay, fine. One more thing, like so you explained about monolithic and microservice architectures, right? So
yes.
Before that, we would like to know more about the what actually the services are and basics actually, like so that we can understand this concept more in detail.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
Okay, can you explain that basic concepts of services?
Yeah, yeah, sure, sure.
Okay, okay.
So you'll be seeing in the next slides. So what actually the service microservice is doing and all. So I hope everyone is good with these two architectures and why are we moving from this one to that one and why are we learning this API in the coming slides as well. So here, as I said in this example, everyone is connected with the programming interfaces. So these programming interfaces is nothing but our API. So API is nothing but application programming interface used for communicating and exchanging data between two separate systems. We can simply understand how API works now. So this is the definition of API, how it serves the purpose in microservice applications. So let's understand how API works with a simple example. Let's take a system which we technically called as a request star. So a system which is requesting something from the other system, we called as a client here. So let's consider this is a client and we are making a request towards the other system, other end of the programming interface, that is the other system. This system we called as a server. So we are sending a request using the client and server is able to take that request and which will process that request and send back some response to the client. So here programming interface performing all the actions to get the information and as well as to provide the services to the client. So you can see the definitions here. Client is a system which requests for services. That is that's an example, web browser, and followed by the server, a program which provides the services. So this whole thing we can see in the browser itself. Let's go to the browser and try to understand how it is working. So as I said, web browser is a client. So using the client, I am navigating to this URL, nothing but I am making a request using the web browser. So what happens is it displays this page. What happened inner side of this system? What happened is using the web browser client, you requested for this particular resource, that is the Google page, to the server. As soon as you hit the enter, the request is sent from web browser client or your machine towards the server, and server sends this kind of a HTML page as a response, but your web browser page converts this HTML page into human readable page like Google, which will provide few services like searching for something and some other services like this. But as soon as you hit the enter, the request is sent to the server and you got the response. Such simple is the interfacing here. So an API which requests for something from one system to the other system and get the response, get the required response is requested for. So coming to the presentation, so here client is our web browser that we have used now. That's a Chrome browser, and you requested for google.com, and you got the Google page as a response to the client system. So this is the whole concept of API. So why microservice became special, and why are we learning API and the testing required for the API? So nowadays it is, everything is distributed, and so many devices, so many distributed system came into picture that we require a flexible environment which provides the services to all the devices and all as well as all third party vendors. So this requires a microservice architecture, and this microservice architecture getting attention since 2014. But this microservice architecture is not a new thing that came like a burst thing into the technology. This is the old one. This is a part of SOA, service oriented architecture, that we will discuss in the comment in the coming classes. But this microservice architecture coming into the attention because of huge distributed system that we require in our technical world. So that's why the graph is going from 2014 to 2018, and you can see the trending of microservices here. So you can see the count of APIs have been increased from 2005 to the 2013, and those are still increasing. I found this graph somewhere in the Google. Here is the public APIs that are exposing to the public to explicitly use their services instead of completely getting into their architecture. We can directly use the public APIs to get few of their services, their actual services for our purposes. So this is the count of APIs. Those were increased year by year, and it is about 10,000 plus APIs. Now it is about 1 lakh plus or so, or these are, the count is increasing more and more because it is serving the purpose without affecting our existing system. So let's get back to the slides again. So not only this, tech stars or tech giants like Netflix, Amazon, and eBay have been talking about the microservice architectures continuously and delivering their features and in the microservice manner itself. They are developing a new feature and testing it thoroughly and adding that particular subservice to the whole system and deploying that service to the live audience. So this is the quick manner to add some feature or the required feature for the user as quickly as possible. Not only this, it increases the productivity of our system, and we require few things always needs to be available as soon as possible to the users. Suppose if you can take any system, any application like WhatsApp, Paytm, or the Netflix, or the Amazon Web Services, or the YouTube, any tech giants you can take. So features have been developing and deploying very fast manner using the microservices itself. So here let's take an Amazon example. So if you can, if you want to do a simple shipment of a simple product, we will be using EIT services to that particular service happen. Means EIT different APIs are working for a particular product to ship to our home. So this is a single process, selecting an item and then adding that to the cart and making the payment and delivering that to the home. So this simple process taking EIT APIs to work inside the Amazon website. So microservices provides these kind of various features, and we require huge testing activities related to microservice, because we have built our own system which provides all the services, and we are going to add a new feature into the existing system. Means we have to build a new feature as a separate component or the subservice, and then we have to test thoroughly that particular component, and we can make that as a bug free, and then we are going to add this particular feature to the existing application. Means we have to do some kind of integration testing with the existing application that we actually require, and followed by the automation we anyway require for continuous integration using any of the tools. So this is the reason why we are going to learn API testing or the microservices testing. It's a functional or a kind of automation testing. It's came into picture because of this purpose. I hope I am done with the basic things, why we are into this kind of architecture, and why the tech giants are using this API, and what actually microservices are serving the purpose as like a monolithic systems, and why are we going to learn this whole course related to the API testing and the tools that we require. I hope I have been covered all the things, and in the coming session I'm going to cover about client server architecture, how it will work and how it serve the purpose in our course, and followed by the parts of API and as well as URL, how we can actually get deeper into the API things. And if you have any question, you can post now or you can ask directly. By that I'll try to answer the things.
Vishwak,
yeah,
basic question, what's the difference between this API and services? Like, are we can use the term in interchangeably, or yeah, it's like there's, yeah, some difference. Yeah.
So I have I was also collected few questions actually which are confusing as soon as you coming to the API picture. What are the web service, what are the API, what are the SOA kind of thing. So service oriented architecture is the root cause. That is the other topic that we will discuss. So that is the root for the API and web services. Here API itself and application programming interface, this is the other part of the system, and service which provides the service to the other component, this is also another part of the system. Here, actually, if we search for API versus services in the Google, we will be floating with interchangeably using of these words, which is not actually good, or the kind of, sometimes it is like it's fine to use, but sometimes not. Let's understand what actually the things. API is a simply application programming interface. We can take the example as REST APIs, and web services, which provides the services and which internally uses API to get the services and provide the services to the clients. So we can take the example as SOAP UI. In between, we can call the REST as also the web services. Here, application programming interface is internal to the service that we are using. Hence, web services is the topmost thing. In that, two things were categorized, that is the SOAP web services and RESTful web services. And there are some other services which are not into limelight, but we so far seeing the SOAP web service and as well as RESTful web services under the web services thing, and then we will be seeing application programming interface. Every web services which internally uses application programming interface, that is interfacing with the component, is happening internally to the website, to the SOAP and to the RESTful. We can call as SOAP API and we can call as REST API. So interfacing between the system which we require in the every web service. I hope I answered your question.
So, at a high level, we need to understand it as web services, and then it can be, according to the needs, it can be divided as SOAP API and REST API, right?
Yeah, yes. Yes, that is what I'm saying. So the high level component is a web service that is categorized into different web services. So in that web services, so every component is should connect with each other using one programming interface that we call as API.
Okay, got it.
Vishwak, I have a question.
Yeah.
If my understanding is wrong, please correct me.
Yeah.
So API is okay. Let me come with a sample. I have an e-commerce site.
Okay.
And I do have a payment integration.
Okay.
So in these two, I'll be transferring my I'm going to purchase a book, and I'll be filling my user details through an API.
Okay.
And once that user details and entering is finished, I'll be navigated to the payment gateway page.
Okay.
So in this scenario, can we consider the payment gateway provider as a service, web service, and the details which I am filling is for an API?
Okay. So I hope I understood the question correctly, that the service that service provider is providing to get the information from the user, that is entering the details, is a one particular thing, and okay. Payment processing which is happening is the other thing, right?
Yes.
Two separate components that we are doing using a single application here. So you are saying that is that an API where it is working behind one service, or the web services is working behind other service? So it is completely up to the development. How suppose you are saying about a payment gateway. So payment gateway might be the a third party vendor. So it is providing the services to the our application. Let's consider Paytm itself. Paytm provides its services after login itself. So login means we are providing our username and password. So this is one process, and as well as the payment gateway integration. This payment gateway integration is the third party thing. This third party is providing their services to the Paytm. Hence, it is obviously the web service kind of thing only. So which, as always I said, which anyway using the API, where you are saying about the login thing and entering our details and setting, you know, selecting one component, it is independent to the Paytm system itself, independent to our system itself, because we can develop using the APIs or we can develop is like a monolithic system. It is to us. We can decide ourselves inside our company, and then we can decide the same purpose using either using the API, either using other languages as a monolithic system. It can be anything, but the third party services will be the web services as well. Always.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. So as I'm seeing one question from Nikhil, please let me know the differences between API services and microservices. I hope I answered this question. And some name is showing like administrator. Hi Vishwak, how much Java is required for API automation testing? The required Java I am covering in this course content, and that's all that is required for the to do the automation for the APIs.
And Vishwak,
yeah,
the main reason behind that asking that particular Java question, right?
Yeah,
is to know whether he need to learn any Java before attending these sessions. So does he need to prepare?
No, not actually required. I have been covering from the basics to the more advanced concepts. So I hope I can say those are enough to do the automation.
Okay. And one more thing is, like, we still feel that there is a bit confusion between the like web services and API. And do you think that these things we can understand in the upcoming sessions, like after going through a few sessions, can we understand in detail about what is the difference between the API and web services? And
as this is a first session, and these buzzwords are common in the Google itself, so it's fine. As I said, the actual technical reason how API is interconnected to the microservices, and how the web services, how the web services categorized. But in order to get the clear picture of how in order to get the clear picture, we need a practical reason or the practical example that we require or that we can perform in the coming sessions. It's fine. For now, you can understand that web services is the high level component. In that, as per the needs, we categorize it that services as a SOAP and as well as RESTful web service. So in that, every web service which internally needs a programming interface, that we call as API. So which serves the purpose as getting the information and providing the response, requesting for the information and providing the response to the between the client and the server.
Okay, fine. Yeah.
Any other questions or confusions, you can post me. So by that, I'll try to answer.
Okay, Venkat is asking another question. Could you please look into that?
Yeah, are we going to do the project at the end or we'll be doing parallelly? So yes, we are going to do it parallelly. Like as soon as we complete with theoretical things, like understanding each basic concept of API and its parts, and definitions, and followed by the services that subcontents provided. Once we are good to go, and once we are done with the things which are actually required to do the functional or automation testing, we can get started parallelly with the functional tool and as well as with the automation tool as well. This is not we are going to explain about all the things and the end, which is not actually the good practice to understand how the things are going on. So that's why we are going with the parallelly itself. So will you provide us the API for practicing? Yeah, I think yes, we can. In future, I think we will be providing this kind of services, like providing a simple API to practice yourself. I think we need to, I mean, QFAX itself needs to discuss about this requirement. In near future, we will be providing this service as well. But for now, there are many resources available in the Google itself. You can search and you can you can play with the APIs itself. I'll provide all those resources in the class whenever required, and then you can do practicing with those resources.
Okay, one question, Vishwak, like, are these APIs which you are trying to provide us for our practice, right, are they going to be kind of realistic or like very basic ones, or like
can those we are get the realistic API? Itself
yeah
those
okay.
are realistic is itself. So I'll be going to explain the APIs which are related to Facebook, Google and Twitter APIs. So using the APIs itself, you can do you can perform a few things in your Facebook account itself. So like that, I'll be giving the realistic API examples in the coming sessions.
Okay. Vishwak, actually before enrolling for this course, I've tried for rest assured automation. While performing that, I found some issues in adding jar files. So okay. Will you be providing us the jar files side-by-side, parallelly?
What kind of a jar files that you need actually?
Like, for rest assured, we should add some jar files for performing automation, right?
Yeah, yeah.
So will you be providing us those?
Let me answer.
We actually have online resources for them. We can directly import if you can use Maven or Gradle build tools. So as soon as you adding the dependency into our services, we will get those jars. I think we do not have any explicit or third party jars we require to do the automation using Rest Assured.
Okay, fine.
So, Vishwak, like one thing here, like you will be demonstrating complete things, right, for everyone, like how to configure the Rest Assured framework and all those stuff as part of this session.
Yeah, yeah, which includes, because you know some people may be new to the frameworks, right? So we need all the steps to be covered.
Okay, I think as part of that, we can provide the jar files to them, right?
Yeah, yes. Yeah, so whichever required, we can provide the online resource for them. They by that they can add the dependence and then they get it.
At the same time, we can demonstrate like how to configure using those things from which locations and all, so that they can do it properly.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Was that answering your question, like Sridhar?
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions, guys, before we wind up? Okay, guys, thanks for attending today's session. So this was the first session we did today, and we are going to cover more basics tomorrow, like the more basics of basics kind of thing, which are required for understanding the API and web services in detail. Okay, so let's wind it up for today, as we don't have any more questions, and let's meet tomorrow at the same time, guys. Thank you for attending. See you guys.
Thank you guys. Thank you for attending.
Bye guys. See you.